morning, good morning on this Sunday morning. It's the 29th of August and we are gathered together as the family of God. And I trust you are well and you are full of faith, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. I'm blessed today to minister the word of the Lord to you, and I believe that your heart is going to be blessed, your life is going to be blessed by the word of the Lord. It's such a powerful thing to receive the word of God and to live in the power of the word of God. So this morning, as we gather together as the family of God, let us open our hearts to one another, let us love one another, and let us encourage one another in this time. Yeah, today we're going to take up the offering. Giving should be from our hearts. Because when our heart is in something, it makes a huge difference in our lives. The poor people are often the most generous people. Just recently, I visited Pastor Gerard and his team's street outreach. And they went out on a Tuesday night and they preached the gospel and they fed the homeless. And right after the meeting, towards the end, quite a poor man came forward and he gave 100 rand, which I think was quite a lot of money for him. And he just gave that 100 rand. His heart was filled with gratitude because he was touched by the word, he was touched by the generosity, and he opened his heart and he wanted to be a blessing. And that is why we give. We give from our hearts because we want to be a blessing. We are the children of God. We are generous. And we read here in the book of 2 Corinthians 9 verse 7. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion. For God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. When we give out of generosity, out of gratitude, God loves that. Not under compulsion, not reluctantly, but cheerfully. We give for the kingdom of God because we are not giving to men, but we are giving to God and we are giving to His kingdom. So let us take up the offering this morning.
Sal God sy Down.
This morning is for the church, the body of Christ, not a building. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We are the church, all of us together as believers are the church of the living God. So we need to understand when we come together, the Lord is present in His church. Wherever we are, there is the church. And I'm speaking this morning to the church, the body of Christ, the ecclesia, the one another church, the church that lives for one another and for the Lord Jesus Christ. And today I want to speak to you on the theme of four brothers of your winning strategy. Yes, four brothers of your winning strategy. And we're going to read here in Mark chapter 2 from verse 2 to 4 from the Passion Translation. Soon there were so many people crowded inside the house to hear him that there was no more room, even outside the door. While Jesus was preaching the word of God, four men arrived. These are our four brothers. Four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man. That paralyzed man could be you or me in this time of crisis. But when they realized that they couldn't even get near him because of the crowd, they went up on top of the house and tore away the roof above Jesus' head. And when they had broken through, they lowered the paralyzed man on a stretcher right down in front of him. I want to ask you a question this morning. Is there a winning strategy for God's people in this last hour? Yes, we are living in the last hour before the Lord Jesus Christ will come for his bride and come and take us away, snatch us away, changes us in a twinkling of an eye. He will transform us and he will give us a new body. We'll be raptured away to meet him in the clouds. We are in the very last hour. And the question is there a winning strategy for us as children of God in this time? I believe there is a winning strategy. And that winning strategy is in the church, in the body of Christ. It's not out there. It is in here, in the body. Like Noah was in the ark, so we are also in the ark. The Lord gave us an ark, the ark of rescue, the ark of his protection, the ark of his provision. There is a winning strategy. The ark was God's winning strategy in the time of Noah to save him and his family and to bring them into the new world. What we need to keep in mind this morning is that there are two major components of our winning strategy that I want to highlight this morning and bring to you. And number one is focus, our focus. What are we focusing on daily in our lives? Right in the beginning of the lockdown in 2020, the Lord spoke to me and he told me that he wanted me to come and rest at his feet, like Mary, sit at his feet, rest in him. And I've learned in this time of this crisis to come and rest at the feet of the Lord. And the Lord started teaching me about how to rest in his presence. I've spoken about this word rest in an acronym. The R speaking about remembering the covenant of the Lord, the E to enter his presence, the S to surrender all to the Lord, and the T to trust him in this. So every morning in my personal time, I go into my closet and I go and sit at the feet of Jesus and I get my focus on him. I see him on the cross. I focus on him on the cross because our covenant begins at the cross. I get my focus off everything else and I discipline myself to focus on him, to focus on his victory on the cross, to focus on the benefits of the covenant, to focus on the victory of the cross. I focus on the blood of Jesus. I focus on the wounds of Jesus. I focus on Isaiah chapter 53. I focus on Psalm 103 to get my mind focused on him, on Jesus. Because that is where our covenant begins. And then I begin to praise him and worship him and go into his presence. And once I sense his presence, I begin to surrender all my anxieties, all my fears. I surrender to him. until I sense that I'm getting a peace in my heart. And then I say to him, Lord, now I trust in you. And I'll take a promise and I just declare that promise over my life. So my focus is very, very important. It is a component of the winning strategy. In the book of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, we read, we look away from the natural realm and we fasten our gaze onto Jesus, who birthed faith within us and who leads us forward into faith's perfection. So what I understand from this scripture is that yes, we came to the Lord through faith, because Jesus is the author of our faith. But he's not only the author of our faith, he's also the finisher of our faith. So he's leading us forward and he's bringing us into the perfection of faith. Day by day, he does this in our lives to bring us into perfection of faith. But we need to focus on him and not on the storm, because we will get distracted. So we need to bring our focus back onto Jesus every morning. Remember how Peter walked on the water when there was a storm raging. As long as he had his eyes fixed on Jesus, he walked on the water. He walked in the conquering power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus conquered the world. He already defeated the world. And his power is available to us. That conquering power is available to you and to me. And that is part of the divine strategy for us in the end times. He wants us to come into his conquering power, to conquer this world through our faith, just like he conquered the world. In John 16, verse 33, we read, and everything I've taught you is so that the peace which is in me will be in you and will give you great confidence as you rest in me. For in this unbelieving world, you will experience trouble and sorrows. But you must be courageous, for I have conquered the world. That's powerful. And when we focus on Jesus, we receive power to conquer this world. We will overcome fear. That paralyzing grip of fear will be broken over us. Now, what can break that paralyzing grip of fear? Number one, our focus. And then number two, balance. Say balance. We need to have a spiritual balance in this time. We need the four brothers of balance, those four men that brought that man that was paralyzed to the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember how they could not enter the house because Jesus was surrounded by a crowd. So what did they do? They worked together and they took their friend and they put him on a, I imagine, a stretcher, and they tied four ropes on each corner of the stretcher. And each one of them took his part of his rope, and then they got onto the roof and they broke open the roof. They tore it open. And this is what I want to bring to you this morning, because God is the God of breakthrough. And he wants us to break through in this time. To break through from out the natural world into the supernatural power of God. From our natural perception of what is going around us into the spiritual perception and understanding what is happening in our world. Now, these four friends or four brothers will help us to break through. They tore open the roof. That speaks of a breakthrough. But then they had to lower this man down, the paralyzed man. He could not help himself because he was paralyzed. And so it is with many of us in this time. We are paralyzed by the spirit of fear that is ruling now in this world. It is a spirit of fear that is ruling the nations of the world. And I say again, that spirit of fear is not, it's not of God. because God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a sound mind. We've got a sound mind. We've got the mind of Christ in this time. We cannot be deceived as children of God if we have got the mind of Christ. We can see clearly. We can understand what is happening in the world. But we need these four brothers in our lives to keep balance. Those four men got on top of the roof. And just think how important it was to do it in a balanced way. They had to coordinate with each other. Otherwise, their friend would have dropped off the stretcher and hurt himself. So they had to balance the stretcher and slowly lower this man down right in front of the feet of Jesus. And this is what balance will do in this time. If our focus is on Jesus and we have this balance, the four brothers of balance in our lives, we will get to the feet of Jesus. And when we get to the feet of Jesus, we will receive a miracle, because you cannot sit or be at the feet of Jesus and do not experience a miracle in your life, because Jesus is a miracle working. He is a miracle worker. He is the Son of God, the miracle worker. He is the Word of God, the miracle worker. He is the God of breakthrough. He is the God of restoration. He is the God of healing. He is the God of provision and protection. He is the God that goes out before us. He makes a way for us. He is our shepherd that leads us in this time. So these four brothers of balance, what are they? Number one, we need a brother. You need a brother of affection. It is that brother, if you look next to you, you'll see your brother of affection. That brother that honors you. That brother that loves you in spite of your shortcomings. Maybe you've messed up, but that brother loves you. He loves you with a brotherly affection. He has got the love of Holy Spirit in his heart, and he loves you the way Jesus loves you. He cares about you. You need that brother in your love, somebody that can minister the love of Jesus to you, the affection of Jesus to you. That's why you cannot be isolated in this time. If you are isolated, the lion is going to catch you. That's a reality. I'm told that there in the game reserve, when you go out on a game drive, on one of those Land Rovers, they will drive right into a pack of lions, where the lions are busy feeding on a carcass. And those lions will not even take care, or they won't even notice you on that vehicle. They are so focused on their prey at that moment, on their meal, that they don't really focus on anything else. But if you should get up immediately, you will draw their attention. When you are in that vehicle sitting down together with all the other people there, that lion sees you as a whole. He cannot discern. He does not know that there is a person, or there is food for him. No, but once you get up, you stand up, you are in trouble. And this is how it is when people isolate themselves, when they are outside the body of Christ in this time. They are becoming prey of the devil, who walks around like a roaring lion. That's why we need to be in the body of Christ. We need to be in one another's church. Can you say amen? And you need that brother, number one, the brother of affection, that brother that loves you with a brotherly love. We read in Romans chapter 12, verse 10, love one another with brotherly affection. outdo one another in showing honor. Notice the word one another. We are in house church. We've got cells. We've got house church, that is congregation. And then we also have celebration. We come together on Sunday mornings at the building, and there we have celebration. And there is a dynamic in the cells. There is a dynamic in the house church, the congregation. And there is a dynamic in the celebration that differ from each other. But we need all of this together to come to maturity. The Lord will use this. Pastor Gerard explained it last week when he spoke about the tabernacle of Moses, the outer court, and then the holy place, and then the most holy place. The outer court is like the cells. We reach out, we win souls, and we bring them in, people in there, and there is surrender. They surrender their life to Jesus. They become a living sacrifice for the Lord. And then we take them into the holy place. That is a congregation where we come together as the body of Christ in the house church. But then we also go into the presence of God, into celebration, the most holy place where we worship together and the glory of God can come down upon us. It's a holy experience that we have. The second brother is the brother keeper. I call him the brother keeper. It's that brother that holds you accountable. Who knows, we all need such a brother in our lives. That brother that will bring us back into line if we go out of line. That brother, it's like an accountability partner. Somebody that loves us enough. He cares so much about us that He will not allow us to go astray. He will not allow us to backslide. He will keep us. He will hold us accountable. He is the brother keeper because of His love. We all need that kind of brother in our lives because it brings balance in our lives. Sometimes we lack discipline and things of the world will come into our lives. But that brother that keeps us, that brother that cares for us to even reprimand us if necessary. He will discipline us if necessary. Why? Because He loves us. He cares about us. It's that kind of brother that will ask us, where were you when we had house church or cells or celebration? It's not like Cain that said, am I my brother's keeper? When the Lord asked him, where is Abel? And he answered the Lord, am I my brother's keeper? Of course, in the body of Christ, we are our brother's keepers. Can you say amen? Hebrews 10 verse 25 says, and let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of His return is drawing near. We need to hold each other more accountable than ever before because we understand before Jesus returns, there is a great apostasy that is taking place. We are in that right now. People are falling away. They are backsliding right now here in the last hour. That is why we need a brother that will keep us accountable. The brother keeper. Number three. We need that brother bearer, that brother that will bear your burdens, that brother that will help you in your needs, in a time of need. That brother, you can go to him in the middle of the night and he will wake up, he will rise up and he will come and help you. It is that brother that will assist you, stand by with you. He's a helper. You need a helper. You cannot stand alone. Maybe you say, yes, but I've got the Holy Spirit. Yeah, you have got the Holy Spirit. See, some people are so spiritually minded that they think that their relationship with God is so holy and so exclusive that nobody else has got a part in that. God works through His body. We are the body of Jesus. You cannot have a a relationship with the Lord without the body of Christ. Because the Lord works through his body. And there is a brother that is your burden bearer. It is that brother that he has got compassion for you. He feels your burden. He sees your burden. And he will make things lighter for you. He will help you. He will assist you. Why? Because he loves you. He cares about you. He wants you to go forward. He doesn't want you to backslide. That is the brother bearer. Like in Galatians chapter 6 verse 2 we read, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. It is this brother, he fulfills the law of Christ. He loves you as a brother to help you, to assist you in the time of your need. And then the last one, the fourth brother, is the brother of comfort. It is that brother that shares your hopes and dreams. He wants you restored. He wants you back on your feet. Is that brother that even though you slip, fell down, he will not condemn you, but he will comfort you. He will come in and stand by with you and comfort you. And he will point forward. He will share your hopes, your dreams, and he will encourage you. Why? Because he wants to get you back on your feet. It is that brother, Holy Spirit works through him or her. When I speak about brothers, I'm including sisters here as well. It is that one that will comfort you. It's that person, that brother, that will agree with you and your hopes and your dreams. He will help you to get up, to get restored. That is his heart, to see you restored in your faith. Maybe you came under a spirit of disappointment or discouragement, but this brother will come and comfort you. Maybe you lost somebody. He will come and comfort you. He will not condemn you. He will comfort you. This is what we read in 2 Corinthians 13. Corinthians 13. Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Aim for restoration. See, this brother of comfort, he aims for restoration. This is what he wants in your life. He wants to see you restored. He wants to see you restored in your relationship with the Lord. Maybe you have backslidden, but he will come and comfort you. Why? Because he wants you to be restored in your relationship with the Lord. He wants you to restored in your relationship with the body of Christ. He wants you to be restored as a person, in your faith, in your commitment, in your zeal for the Lord. The word says, comfort one another, agree with one another, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Praise the Lord. This is what we need. We need his peace in our hearts. Family of God, when that man was lowered in a balanced way, slowly, he came right down. Everything else stopped. Every person's focus or eyes were fixed upon this man, fixed upon Jesus, and how Jesus was going to handle this situation. And that man was lowered down, right down, until he was at the feet of Jesus. And then the winning strategy worked for him. Jesus spoke to him. And remember, Jesus forgave his sins. And then Jesus also told him to make up his bed and to go home. He was restored. See, he had a winning strategy. He was not alone. And his friends, his brothers, helped him to receive His miracle. And I want to encourage you this morning. You need a breakthrough. You need a miracle. It's only Jesus that can give you that miracle, that breakthrough. Maybe you've lost your job. Maybe your business is bankrupt. Or maybe you are sick in this time. Maybe you are so paralyzed with fear. I want to encourage you this morning. Get your focus back on Jesus. Get into the body of Christ. Get your four brothers. Let them come around you. Let them come and minister into your life. And something miraculous is going to happen. You are going to experience the Lord Jesus. You are going to feel His brotherly love, His affection. You are going to feel accountable. Become accountable again in the body of Christ. You see, we are not lone rangers. We are called into the body of Christ. We've got a function in the body of Christ. There in the house church, we can't sit back, but we need to rise up and find out what is our function. We need to find out what is our gifting so we can begin to work in the body of Christ so that Jesus can work through us, touch people. We should go out on the streets. We should preach the gospel. We should help the poor in this time, cast out demons. We should not be self-centered, but we need to see the harvest that is out there. That is our reward. God wants to give us our reward. So I want to encourage you this morning, because there are many people that are paralyzed, children of God that are paralyzed. And then I'm not speaking physically, I'm speaking about spiritually. People that they are so paralyzed by the things of this world that they are not reaching out. They are not functioning in the body of Christ. They are merely just like passengers. God doesn't want you to be a passenger. He wants you to be an active member of the body. I'm giving you four components. These four brothers that you need in your life to help you to get back on your feet, to break that spirit of fear, that spirit that paralyzes you. And these four brothers will speak into your life, they will minister into your life, and they will break through for you, and they will help you to see Jesus. They will help you to experience Jesus, and Jesus will touch you. He will break that spirit of paralysis over you, and He will set you free. He will activate you. He will empower you, and He will move you forward in your faith. So we're going to worship now, and the presence of the Lord is going to come. He's going to manifest Himself, and then after the worship, you are going to minister to one another and trust the Lord for breakthrough. Trust the Lord for healing, deliverance, restoration. And then we're going to have the communion after that. God bless you. Amen.
Oh, fear in our chest. At every door our Savior's knocking. Oh, let Him in. Oh, let Him out. With every yes, His kingdom's coming. Oh, sound of every saint rejoicing. Oh, Jesus Christ, the hope of glory. Yes, Lord. Atmosphere is changing. The atmosphere is changing. Can you feel it changing with us? As we sing these words, the atmosphere is changing. The atmosphere is changing. As we sing these words, atmosphere is change. The atmosphere is change. Sing one more time with us, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus.
Yeah. is in the dark, over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.